Historically, psychology began as a combination of philosophy and experimental physiology. It used the methodology of experimental physiology to answer the questions of philosophy. Experimental physiology was interested in measuring neurons, explaining how the brain works, and discovering the basic elements of memory, learning, and personality. You may have heard of galvanized steel or galvanized nails. It is a process of bonding zinc to steel using electricity. Someone who suddenly jumps into action is said to be galvanized or to have galvanized resolve. All these are derivatives of Luigi Cavani's name. Galvani is credited with the discovery that nerves are electrical. Before Galvani, nerves were thought to be spiritual. The premise was that the human spirit activates the body. Since spirits travel instantaneously from place to place, you can have your body energized by your spirit. Similarly, animals are inhabited by animal spirits. His discovery started with an accident. Galvani had a number of other experiments in process. Some involved the use of a Leyden jar, which stores the charge formed by a rotating static electricity generator. On another table, there was a dissected frog. An assistant accidentally touched one of the wires from the Leyden jar to the spinal cord of the frog. A spark was generated by the jar, and the frog's muscles all jerked at once. That was the start. Galvani then followed with a series of experiments. He showed that muscles respond to electricity, even when they are not attached to the frog. Galvani believed that electricity was some sort of liquid sent to or stored in the muscles. So now there were three kinds of electricity. Artificial electricity, which is static electricity generated by friction. Natural electricity, lightning. And animal electricity, which is secreted by the brain and flows through the nerves to activate the muscles. The leading physiologist of his day, Johann Muller, studied voice, speech, hearing, blood, and the lymph system. His eight-book series, Elements of Physiology, was the authority on all areas of physiology. In contrast to the thinking of his day, Muller held that each nerve leads to one sensation only. The message a nerve carries is not determined by the stimulation, visual, auditory, or tactile, but by the brain. If the eye is stimulated by touch, electricity, or light waves, the result is a visual sensation. This law of specific nerve energies replaced the prevailing view that there were different kinds of nerves for different senses. Muller was also a vitalist. Vitalism maintained that the wonder of life can't be reduced to chemical, electrical, or physiological processes. Life is qualitatively different and more than the sum of its parts. Although Franz Gall was among the first comparative anatomists, he is best known for suggesting that there is a relationship between personality and head bumps. Popular with the general population, phrenology assumed that mental functioning could be determined by observing the variations in skull structure. Gall believed that each of the brain's faculties, skills, abilities, and personality traits, was restricted to a region of the brain that specialized in that faculty. Unlike the heart, which uses its entire structure to do one task, the brain does multiple tasks at the same time, each in its respective part of the brain. In addition, the brain, like a muscle, increases in size with exercise and use. The more one used the honesty area of the brain, the larger it would get. As that area of the brain continues to increase in size, it puts pressure on the skull, forcing it to expand. According to this view, expanded portions of the brain are seen as bumps on the skull and represent increased ability or enhanced processing. Depressions on the skull indicate underdeveloped areas and represented deficits in ability and quality. The topology of the head, then, was used to diagnose skills, inabilities, and personality traits. The contour of the skull and face also was thought to reflect one's honesty, integrity, and future potential. Consequently, by examining the skull, phrenologists could objectively describe the mental functions and personal qualities that characterized that individual. There was no theoretical rationale for the number of brain regions used by phrenology. Although Gall identified 26 areas of the brain, his followers expanded it to 35. Gall's association with phrenology, what he called cranioscopy, overshadows his other accomplishments. His thorough anatomical observations and studies in comparative anatomy were remarkable for his day. Gall compared the brains and skulls of several species and concluded that brain size and mental capacity were correlated. Larger-brained animals were capable of performing more complex and more varied tasks. This was a major discovery for which he gets little credit. Phrenology became so accepted in the general population that the scientific community became concerned. To settle the dispute, Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, ordered the Academy of Sciences of Paris to study Franz Gall's claims. The Academy chose French physiologist Pierre Flourens to investigate the matter. Flourens showed that Gall was partially correct. The brain does have different areas of function. Perfecting the technique on pigeons, Flourens removed portions of the brain and observed the effects. His extirpation procedure, destroying small parts of the brain, revealed that each part of the nervous system had its own function and acted as a unit. Removal of the cerebral hemispheres resulted in the loss of perception and judgment. Removal of the cerebellum causes loss of equilibrium and an inability to coordinate motor movements. Removal of the brainstem resulted in death. Flourens is also known for his studies of bone formation, and he was a pioneer in the use of anesthesia. Hermann Helmholtz became famous for several discoveries of his own. He invented the ophthalmoscope, an instrument used to look into the eye and examine the retina. He revived Thomas Young's theory of color vision and hypothesized the presence of separate cone pigments long before their existence could be experimentally proved. Helmholtz also showed that the ear's basilar membrane vibrates sympathetically to stimulation. His first accomplishment was a major proof of the law of conservation of energy. Using physiological examples, Helmholtz showed that an empirical approach could be applied to both physics and physiology. Helmholtz rejected Muller's vitalism in favor of physical monism. The popular view of his time was that behavior was the result of the human spirit moving through the body. Since God's spirit can move instantaneously, and people are created in the image of God, the human spirit can move instantaneously too. The reason you can move fingers on both hands at the same time is that the human spirit travels so fast it can activate one finger and rush to the other hand in time to activate the other. Since this occurs spiritually, it's impossible to measure the speed of the human spirit. Helmholtz reasoned that the way to test this idea was to stimulate a nerve close to and far away from a muscle. If the human spirit theory was correct, there should be no difference in response time. So in 1850, Helmholtz invented the myograph and used it to measure the speed of a nerve impulse. He found a difference in response times and discovered that the speed is surprisingly slow. Light travels at 186,000 miles per second. In the same amount of time, a nerve impulse travels only 90 feet.